مدینہ 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 مدینہ.
Assalamu alaikum to our viewers and welcome to the program. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Today the topic that we are going to talk about is anger, ghussa. And the literal meaning of anger is something that is stuck in the throat. I will quote you the different explanations that have been given to us on anger. First one is by Jafar bin Muhammad, and according to him he says that anger is the key to all evil. Secondly, we see according to Abdullah bin Mubarak, he was asked if he could explain Husn-e-Akhlaaq in one statement. He said to leave anger. What is Husn-e-Akhlaaq? To leave anger. And thirdly, we see according to Hasan Basri Rahmatullah Alayh, he said that if at these four points, if somebody can control himself or somebody can remain in balance, he will be saved from shaitan and he will be saved from the hellfire. First is when he is having an urge or to fall into for something. Secondly, when he has a physical desire, if he can control himself then. Thirdly, when he is in the state of fear, if he can control himself, balance himself at the time of fear. And lastly, it was said that if he can control himself at the time when he is angry. If at these four moments a person can control himself, he will be saved from shaitan inshallah and he will be saved from the hellfire. Now we will also see that anger has three different stages. There are stages of anger. Sakhata is the first stage of anger. This is when you see something that you don't like. For example, somebody comes and he has hit you by his elbow, or you were working and somebody came and said something to you which you didn't like. So this first feeling of dislike is called sakhata. Now it is irrespective whether you will show a reaction or not. Whether you ignore it, whether you say something in return, that is irrespective. Second stage of anger is called ghaiz. Ghaiz is when you see something that you dislike, you are a little offended, and to the extent that your heart starts to palpitate. There is palpitation of heart. This is called ghaiz. Again, it is irrespective whether you will show a reaction or not. So this first stage is sakhata. The second stage is ghaiz. And we will also see that the third stage is ghazab. Ghazab is the generally word which is used for anger. This is the general word used for anger. And this is where one shows a reaction, and the outcome of this reaction, for whatever is going to fall after this reaction, is then called hard. So there is sakhata, there is ghaiz, there is ghazab, and then there is hard. Now of course this is very logical that what the intention behind anger is will definitely bring out the consequences similarly. Why? Because anger is a natural tool of defense. It's a defensive mechanism. It's a defense mechanism. And it is something very natural. And Allah has kept anger in us. Why? Because I want to protect myself. So I will use something to protect myself which comes out in the form of anger. So therefore, there are two types of anger, and the reaction to anger can be negative and it can be positive. Today what we are going to discuss will enable us to at least differentiate how to use my anger in a positive way instead of taking it out negatively. Why? Because if I am going to take it out negatively, then of course the outcome and the consequences are going to be negative. But if I am going to use it in a positive way, which is required in Islam, then my outcome is also going to be positive. I will give you a simple example. Just imagine you are going in a car with your children and your child does something wrong which is going to hurt him. Now, to save your child from getting hurt, you are going to show a reaction. So this reaction comes out in the form of anger. But here this anger is positive. Why? Because you want to save your child from getting hurt. On the other hand, ghadab is revenge. And this revenge can at times be negative. And I'm sure you will agree with me that a lot of people, when they come to a reaction, they always overdo the reaction. If, for example, it was enough for you to say that don't do this again. But instead of using this statement, you go one step ahead in the reaction and you start beating up. So revenge, when it comes to revenge, normally we overdo it. And this is what Islam is now going to, and this is what Islam teaches us. To remain within our boundaries, to remain in a balanced attitude, not to cross the limit so that you enter into the category of a transgressor or you enter the category of a zalim, somebody who is unjust. We move on to the preposition that is given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, Surah Ash-Shura, ayat number 37. وَإِذَا مَا غَذِبُوا هُمْ يَغْفِرُونَ. Allah ta'ala says, and when they are angry, they forgive. So here from this ayat, we are going to learn that yes, there was anger, but the alternate given to anger was to forgive. Now to understand this, we will see that there are three different ways to express anger. One is either you're going to express something. Number two is either you're going to suppress it. And number three is that you are going to calm it down. To express anger at times is required. It is the need and it should be expressed. Why? Because if something is not going to be corrected by a reaction, you may get consequences which may even be worse. So sometimes to express anger in a positive way is beneficial. Secondly, if you are suppressing anger, suppressing if it is going to result in a disease. For example, a lot of people suffer from high blood pressure just because they get angry very quickly. Some people tend to go into different forms of depression. Why? Because they tend to lose their temper very easily. So if somebody is going to end up with a disease or he's going to fall sick, then suppressing anger is not desirable. Then it should be expressed positively. Inshallah, later on, we will also see the forms where how can we resolve anger? How can we take care of anger? The third thing is to calm down. Now, how do you calm down? This is what Surah Ash-Shura is explaining in ayat number 37, that when they are angry, they forgive. That means you can only hold on to anger when you have the ability and the tawfiq to forgive. And when can we forgive? When we are soft at the heart. Then we can forgive. And we can forget also. So we see that naturally anger is going to come out. So one should never be worried about that, why do I get angry? It's okay if you get angry. But the question remains, do I know how to help out myself by not showing my anger to the extent that it can bring out negative results? I need to save myself from that. Then we see in Surah Ali Imran, ayat number 134, Allah Ta'ala says, وَالْكَذِمِينَ الْغَيْزِ وَعَفِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ. Allah Ta'ala says, who repress anger and who pardon men. Kazimina al-ghayz. Kazama. Kazama means basically to tie laces, to tie a lace. And ghayz, like I told you, is when your heart starts to palpitate. It starts to boil. So take the example of a water bag. There is boiling water inside the water bag, but you have tied it up. Wal kazimina al-ghayz, they have tied it up. So the hot boiling water inside the water bag is very dangerous. If it spills out, if it splashes out, it may harm somebody. But because you've tied it up, and here I will remind you to bring the literal meaning of anger in mind, that is something stuck in the throat. So when you tie it up, you have saved the harm. It is not going to harm anybody now. But of course, what is inside is very dangerous. And then secondly, وَعَافِينَا عَنِ النَّاسِ. How do they calm themselves down is by forgiving the people. This sort of suppression is desirable, where you can forget and you can forgive. But if somebody is still learning how to forgive, of course, he's going to take time to control his anger. And of course, when we all believe in the fact that Muslims in any form, whether he's my servant, whether he's my colleague, whether he's my boss, we all come from the same fatherhood. And we all may have little ups and downs in our lives. But at the end of the day, we are all one. We all are united. And then these feelings of forgiveness and to forget slowly start to make place in the heart. And then it is easy to take care of anger. First hadith that we are going to learn about today is from Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. And he narrated, Allah's Messenger said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the strong is not the one who overpowers in wrestling, but the strong one is who controls himself in anger. Now in this hadith, we will see that we have been explained about, that there are two different states. One is somebody who is wrestling and one is somebody who is controlling anger. And the better of the two is the one who is controlling anger in terms of bravery, not the one who is wrestling. So let's first take the example of wrestler. Now, wrestlers normally go into different kinds of exercises. They may be taking different kinds of medicines to maintain their strength, or they may be following a certain diet to maintain their strength. And when they are on the stage, they are displaying their strength, basically. They are displaying their power. And the people around them are entertaining themselves by watching that wrestling match. And you must have noticed that wrestling is one of the favorite entertainments for a lot of people. And they just enjoy watching this display of strength and power. But according to the Islamic perception, displaying your strength is not bravery. Sometimes you must have also noticed that people who are very bold, very confident, outspoken, they can quiet you very easily, think that they are brave. But here, this hadith explains us, tells us that no, if somebody who is able to control his anger will be called a brave man. Why? Because he has the authority to do it. And normally, where anger comes out is when you are before a weak person. You know he cannot do anything in return. Like, when there is a robbery in the house and somebody suspects the servant, it is very easy to tell him that I'm going to throw you in the jail. I'll put you through a very hard time. Why? Because he's weak. You know he cannot do anything against you. But Islam encourages us that you need to control your own self despite the fact that you have the ability to do so. And may Allah give us the ability to do so. Second hadith is according to Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, and he narrated that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there is no sip greater in reward near Allah than the sip of anger. The servant suppresses it seeking the pleasure of Allah. In this hadith, we see, just remind yourself again of the literal meaning of anger, that something is stuck in the throat. And this is again very natural, then that when we have to control anger, it is actually gulping down something very hard. And of course, to suppress anger is not very easy at times also. But nothing is more rewardable than swallowing a sip of anger, but for the sake of Allah. I would like to remind our viewers that this series of programs that we are doing during the month of Ramadan is basically to build up good character. What are those things that will help us make a good character? And today, since we are talking about anger, we have to adjust it, how to avoid things in such a way that they become ibadat, that they become a form of worship for us. And Husn-e-Akhlaaq basically itself is ibadat. So here, to sip something down which is not desirable, which is unlawful, why? Because it gives you outcome which is far more destructive. And here the sip that has to be taken of anger is only to please Allah. So that means for a Muslim, whatever he does, the intention definitely counts. Why am I doing it? For whose sake am I doing it? And if I am doing it for myself, to please myself or to please someone else, then that's not worship. Worship only becomes when you're doing something with the intention of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Ramzan is the month to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, it is for the rest of the year also, but because the rewards are multifolds, are many times more than the normal months, then this is the time to please Allah. And while we are fasting, we should try to control our anger. Number one, we should try to control our anger. Why? Because this is the root of all evils. And the reason why we want to be angry is something that I don't like, something that you don't like. Every time that it will come before you that you don't like something, you want to lose your temper. And this is where self-control comes in. And if one can control at this moment, he will be inshallah saved from Satan, and he will be inshallah saved from the consequences of hellfire. Third hadith, Sahal bin Muaz narrated from his father that Nabi Sallam said, whoever suppresses anger, though he is capable of expressing it, Allah will call him in front of the creatures on the day of standing, and he will be given the right to choose any pure-eyed virgin he likes. Mentioning here that, of course, women will also be, women, not just that men have been mentioned, that they will be given a choice to choose, but we also see that in the Quran, according to this hadith, anybody who suppresses anger will be brought forward on the day of resurrection, and Allah is going to give him a choice to go and choose a fair, a big-eyed virgin from wherever he wants to pick. This is just to give a motivation. Why? Because normally you will see that in our culture, men are more prone to get angry as compared to women who are on the weaker side. And it does not mean that women will not be rewarded. Why? Because Quran again tells us that innama yuwaffas sabiruna ajruhum bighayri hisab. For all those who are going to bear and who are going to endure with patience will be rewarded abundantly. So it applies to everybody, but this is just a motivation, and everything comes step by step. That if you are able to control, the rewards are manifold. Then we move on to our next hadith, and this is according to Hazrat Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. He narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, teach and make things easy and do not create difficulty. And when any one of you is angry, he should remain silent. Now in this hadith, Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving us a tip how to control our anger. You be silent. First thing he said was teach and make things easy. Don't make things difficult. And at times a person who remains in a very high temper, most of the time you will see that people tend to leave him. He loses his friends. He loses his relationships, just because he cannot control himself. So Nabi Sissam says, teach and then make things easy, don't make things difficult. And when you are angry, then try to be silent. What do you think silence would do? Silence is a very big tool. Is a very big tool, and it can overcome a lot of hurdles. It helps in overcoming a lot of storms when you are silent. Why? Because silence expresses. Why? Because silence helps you cool down. Silence is a sign of sabr. it is a sign of patience. And when you are able to control this moment by silence, that is also a sign of bravery. Why? Because in the first hadith we read that whoever can control his anger despite the fact that he can show it is brave. So silence is a sign of bravery. A lot of times you must have felt that silence is a sign of weakness. It means I have given in. It means I have accepted that I have lost. No, silence is the biggest tool one can use to avoid a lot of destructive relationships. It can help you maintain. But according to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when you are angry, that means there is a reason to be silent. You don't need to be silent unnecessarily. A lot of people remain silent for no reason. You are trying to make a conversation with them and they are silent with you. You are trying to ask them something, they are still silent. You need to know about something, they are still silent. No, here the reason for being silent is when you are angry. Again, this is a positive outcome. Why? Because you are going to avoid a lot of destruction had you shown your anger and had you gone into a negative reaction. Then we move on to the next hadith. And one thing more that I would like to add here is that we make things difficult. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is explaining here that don't make things difficult. A general trend in our schools, you must have noticed, and especially in the madaris also sometimes, that it is an accepted fact that children will only become Hafiz-e-Quran when they will be beaten up. A lot of mothers take it for granted that children don't listen unless and until you hit them or you beat them. According to this hadith, Nabi Sissam says, do not make things difficult. Do not come to a point where somebody is going to run away from you. And religion, and especially the teachings of religion, are based upon peace. They are based upon justice. And they are based upon harmony. So to bring somebody close to harmony and to justice and to peace, you have to use the silent ways, the subtle ways of the subtle, you have to use the subtle strategies in which there is no hardness of the heart. And if there is hardness of the heart, the result would be again that people are going to run away from the religion. And these ahadiths help us understand that when you make things easy for others, they will step even faster than you thought. They will step forward even faster than you thought. But if I will come up with ideas against the wisdom, because ahadiths are all signs of wisdom. They explain you when, where, how much, how to react. Even if you want to react, how much should you react? So if somebody can understand the wisdom behind the ahadiths, he will be inshallah able to overcome a lot of difficulties that we may come across. Next hadith is, according to Hazrat Anas radiallahu anhu, he narrated that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was neither one who spoke indecently, nor one who cursed, and nor one who abused. And when annoyed, he used to say, "What is wrong with him? May his forehead be dusty." In this hadith again we see that Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of his lifestyle was, he never cursed anybody in his life. He never used an abusive language in his life, and he never spoke indecently. There was no fahash in his language. And last of all, even if he felt upset about something, all his statement was, "What is the matter with him?" Can we think of the moments when we were angry, and what statements have we passed on? And secondly, he would in a way give a dua that may his forehead be dusty. And in this respect, it is very clear that yes, you can show a reaction, you can say something. It's not that you need to suppress it all the time. No, you can express it. But the selection of words is very important. And of course, the outcome that I desire, the outcome that I want to show by my reaction will depend upon the intention behind my reaction. If I want to solve something, then I will show my anger in such a way that will still bring out the correct consequences. It's not a matter of revenge. It's not a matter of showing someone low. No, it is a matter of correction. And I need to show this reaction to correct. So here Nabi Sissam says that yes, that means you can say what is wrong with him. But look at the selection of words. There is no indecency. There is no abusive words here. And at the same time, it is a correction. Then according to Hazrat Abu Zar, radiallahu anhu, he narrates, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, whenever one of you gets angry while he is standing, he should sit down. If anger goes out of him, that's good. But if not, he should lie down. Now again, we have been given a tip of how to manage anger. You must have seen a lot of workshops on anger management. This is another tip that when you feel angry, if you are standing, then you should sit down. If it goes away, fine. If it doesn't go away, go and lie down. And I'm sure some of you must be thinking that who has the time to sit down and who has the time to lie down? Why? Because when you are angry, you have an extra energy in you. Some of you might be thinking that who has the time to sit down when he's angry, or who has the time to lie down? And yes, it is difficult to sit down at times, and yes, it is difficult to lie down. But again, if at the back of my mind I have a positive reaction, I will sit down. Why? Because I didn't want to be angry for the sake of being angry. I'm angry. Why? Because you are angry. Why? Because you want to correct something. So you're trying to bring out positive rays. You're trying to bring out a positive reaction, and for that sake you may sit down. And this is again where taqwa comes in. If I am going to deal situations where I do not want to offend Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where I want to solve things, then I will definitely do what has been explained, what has been told to me, what has been said to me. I will definitely follow that. Then I will lie down also. And in other instances we see that you can drink water, you can go and perform ablution. If it doesn't work, you can go and perform a bath. You can take a bath, drink water, sit down or lie down. Inshallah, there are many other things, of course, because we have very limited time during our programs, and of course the intimate details, or inshallah, there is very much that can be said on this subject. But since we have limited times, I will just give you a few remedies, and inshallah we will come to the end of our program today. That if ever anybody feels angry, a'uzu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. And secondly, he can say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Rabbi a'uzu bika min hamazati shayateen wa a'uzu bika rabbi an yahdharun. These are a few duas from the masnoon ways that one can say when he is angry. May Allah save us from this anger, because anger is from Satan and Satan is made of fire. And may Allah save us from moments where we can come out with negative reactions. And may Allah give us the tawfiq to control ourselves. Wa akhiru da'wana anilhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.